Welcome all of you to the video lecture series on fluid mechanics. This lecture is on topic 3 on fluid kinematics. This lecture 12 is on part 2 of fluid kinematics, where in the part 1 I discussed the first two section, the subsection of this topic, corresponding to description of fluid motion and acceleration and description of rate of motion and deformation. In the part 2 on fluid kinematics, I'll discuss three subsections as shown here, corresponding to vorticity and rotationality, flow visualization, and the Renault transport theorem. The previous lecture, while discussing the description of the motions and deformations, I have presented the rate of rotation and also introduced the vorticity, where I have mentioned the vorticity is mathematically expressed as twice of the angular velocity, and it represents the distribution of the rotationality of the fluid in a flow region. So what the magnitude of vorticity gives us the indication about the rotationality in the flow region locally at different points in the flow region. So in this topic, I'll discuss separately the vorticity, and I'll also discuss the rotational and interrotational. To begin with, let us take an example. Let us consider flow across a horizontal flat plate. So the fluid is moving above the flat plate and it is moving with a constant velocity. Let us suppose the velocity is represented by this value. So this, let us denote this as u infinity. Now this plate is stationary. So the fluid which comes into the contact of this plate has to also needs to be stationary due to the no slip condition. So this is the velocity of the fluid in contact with the plate, but gradually due to viscosity, the upper layer tries to move and there is a viscous resistance corresponding to the stickiness between the different layers of the fluid. And this is the velocity which sets in. This is an external flow problem where far away everywhere the velocity is the free stream velocity, and near to the wall there is a velocity gradient which sets in. So we define later on, we have a separate topic where we define a boundary layer, which is a thin layer in which there is a velocity gradient. So this is the edge of the boundary layer. The edge of the boundary layer is basically decided by it, wherever as you keep moving up, there is a height at which the velocity is 99% of this free stream velocity. So for this location, let us suppose this is the height. So this is the edge of the boundary layer. So at different axial locations, the edge of the boundary layer are shown by this line. So let us consider two different streamlines. One which is outside the boundary layer. So this is the boundary layer. This is the layer above which there is almost zero velocity gradient, and within which the velocity gradient is, or the viscous effect is, restricted. So if you consider a streamline outside the boundary layer, streamline is a line on which the velocity at each and every point is tangent to it. So this, let us, so the any fluid particle which is moving on a streamline will move tangent to the streamline, which follow the streamline, and the fluid particle, you can see as it is moving, it is not having any rotation because there is no unbalanced shear force on this fluid particle. So you can see that it is translating without any rotation. Whereas if you consider a streamline at each and every point of the streamline, the velocity of the flow is tangent to it. So it gives us the direction of the flow. So any fluid particle, if it is passing, if it is following the streamline, then it will not cross the streamline, it will be tangent to it. So in this case, if you see that if you consider a streamline inside the boundary layer, then as it is translating, it is also rotating. So for this streamline, which is inside the boundary layer, this smiling face, which is like a, for a fluid particle, you can see that the smiling face, as it is translating, it is rotating in the clockwise direction. So for a fluid particle inside the boundary layer, what you observe is that there is an unbalanced shear force, because if you see the velocity gradients on the upper side and lower side, there is a difference, and the unbalanced shear force leads to the clockwise rotation of the fluid particle. So any fluid particle inside the boundary layer, which is the viscous region, vorticity also gives, when any flow region has certain rotation, this also gives an idea about the dominance of viscous forces in that region. So these are the different time instant I'm showing you. At time t is equals to 0, delta t, 2 delta t, and 3 delta t. Because as time progresses, what you observe is for a streamline which is outside the boundary layer, where the velocity gradients are negligible, there is no unbalanced shear force, and any fluid particle on a streamline passing, when it passes through a streamline, passes along a streamline, it is only translating, not rotating. Whereas if you consider a streamline within a boundary layer, while translating, a fluid particle is also rotating due to unbalanced shear force. So the region is inside the boundary layer, you can call it as a rotational flow region, and outside you can call it as an irrotational flow region. So the boundary layer separates the rotational flow with the irrotational flow region. As mentioned earlier, vorticity is a measure of rotation of a fluid particle, and it is defined as equal to twice the angular velocity of a fluid particle. This was presented in the previous lecture. If it is zero, then the fluid is not rotating in that flow region, and the flow is called as irrotational. Otherwise, it is rotational. If it is non-zero, then it is rotational. So this is a variable omega, which we call as vorticity. It's a vector quantity, note that. And this is the x component of the vorticity, omega x. This is the y component of the vorticity, omega y. And this is the z component of the vorticity. In the earlier lecture, I had shown while deriving the expression for angular velocity and the rotation, I have in two dimensional, I have shown you the expression for omega z, which corresponds to this. This is basically given as curl of the velocity vector. And so this is omega z is given by del v by del x minus del u by del y. The spatial as well as temporal dynamics in a flow field is represented by velocity and pressure. Like if you draw a fluid dynamics picture or movie, where each picture represents velocity distribution, then the nature of the velocity variation in the fluid dynamic picture can be explained in terms of various forces. Like if you consider flowing a nozzle, by looking into the distribution of velocity within a nozzle, you can get an idea about the inertia force, that the fluid is accelerating as it is moving downstream. You can also get an idea about the viscous forces by looking into the velocity. Like when you see the velocity profile, you can get an idea about the rate at which velocity is increasing or decreasing in a profile. So that way you can get an idea about the viscous forces. When you plot a picture of pressure distribution, you can get an idea about the pressure forces. So when you make a fluid dynamics movie, where actor of your movie is a velocity in one movie, in another movie it could be pressure. So we can make a story of the velocity and pressure variation with the help of this various types of forces, like inertia forces, which is basically the coming from the rate of change of momentum, and this viscous forces and pressure forces, and in certain problem the gravity force also plays the role. However, at many instances it is advantageous to interpret any fluid dynamic movie in terms of vorticity, because it gives us so when you make a movie of the vorticity distribution, you can get an idea about the region in which viscosity is playing a dominant role, where there is an unbalanced shear force. Let me show you a movie, fluid dynamic movie, corresponding to free stream flow across a cylinder, where the dotted line represents the region in which you have clockwise rotation of the fluid, and the solid line represents the region in which you have a anti-clockwise rotation of the fluid. In the previous topic, I had mentioned that there is a flow separation from the upper side as well as on the lower side alternatively, and I had mentioned that there is a clockwise vortex which is formed on the upper half, on the back side of the upper half, and on the back side of the lower half there is an anti-clockwise vortex which is formed. So when I play the movie, you can see that wherever there is a dotted line, locally there the fluid is rotating in the clockwise direction, and wherever you have a solid line, the fluid is rotating in anti-clockwise direction. This is a fluid dynamic movie corresponding to a periodic state where this movie is a clip of the movie corresponding to the periodic state. So you can see this clockwise rotating fluid is moving downstream. This vortex is shredding downstream. This anticlockwise vortex is moving downstream. It is breaking. That's why we call it as a shedding. Breaking is termed as shedding. So vorticity is generated at the solid surfaces and it is diffused and advected away from the solid surface. So note that this vorticity is maximum near to the solid surface because the velocity gradients are maximum near to the solid surface. And the vorticities, you can see they are forming near to the solid surface. They are breaking and moving downstream. That's why they are called as vortex shedding. In the bottom half, you have a shedding of anticlockwise vortex. Top half, you have a shedding of clockwise vortex. These are what we call as line contours of vorticity, where the dotted line represents the negative vorticity, that is the clockwise vorticity, and the solid line represents the positive vorticity, that is an anticlockwise vorticity. Anticlockwise rotation and negative vorticity corresponding to anticlockwise rotation, positive vorticity corresponding to anticlockwise rotation, negative vorticity corresponding to clockwise rotation. Vorticity is generated by unbalanced shear force, as I mentioned earlier, indicating that viscous effects are important because wherever you have a shear stress involves the viscosity. So the viscous effects are important. And vorticity dynamics offers a method to separate a flow into viscous and inviscid effect. Like if the example, if we consider flow across a flat plate, you can see the region inside the boundary layer where you have rotational flow. That is corresponding to the viscous region, and the region outside the boundary layer where the along a streamline the fluid particle was only translating, not rotating. So outside the boundary layer, we can call that region as in where the viscous effects are negligible. So this is an inviscid flow region outside the boundary layer. Near to the wall, you have a viscous region. Vortex refers to a flow in which the fluid rotates. Later on, I will show you streamline with which this will be, I'll explain this more clearly. Vorticity is a representation, it's a variable which represents point-wise distribution of the rotation in a flow. Whereas vortex, when we say it's a certain regions in the flow where the fluid rotates. Now I'll show you two example problems and discuss the rotational flow and irrotational flow with the help of certain cartoons represented by the smiling faces. So let us consider flow inside a rotating cylinder. So this is a cylinder which is rotating in anticlockwise direction as shown here. So the fluid inside this cylinder will also rotate in anticlockwise direction. So you can see that when the fluid is rotating in anticlockwise direction inside this cylinder, a fluid particle which are shown by the smiling faces, you can see when it is rotating, it is the smiling face, you can see that it is turning. So it means that the fluid particle has certain rotationality. This I will show you through certain expression also, that it has non-zero vorticity. Here U represents the radial velocity and V represents the angular velocity, the azimuthal velocity. So here in this case, the radial velocity is zero and the azimuthal velocity is given by the angular velocity multiplied by the radius. We know that vorticity is twice of the angular velocity. So angular velocity equals to vorticity divided by two. So this is the r theta plane. So here the vorticity will be given by omega z. So this is the angular velocity. When it is expressed in terms of vorticity, this is omega z divided by 2. So this is your azimuthal velocity, this is your radial velocity. This is the expression of vorticity in the z direction when you consider a cylindrical polar coordinate system, 1 by del r of rv minus 1 by r del u by del theta. So when you substitute this u and v, you get omega z is equal to 2 omega naught. which indicates that you have a non-zero vorticity. So this is a problem which corresponds to a rotational flow. So for the same problem, if you consider the fluid rotating inside, it's a rotational flow. On the next problem which we will consider is there is a flow, the fluid is rotating, the fluid is in contact with a rotation outside. Like if you consider flow across a rotating shaft, okay, which is like a flow outside a rotating cylinder. Earlier problem was flow across a flow inside a rotating cylinder. Now here it's a flow outside a rotating cylinder. Now in this case, if you look into this cartoon, so in this case, this is a shaft or a cylinder, which is solid cylinder, which is rotating in anti-clockwise direction. So in this, what you are seeing is that the fluid, the smiling faces, if you look, as it is moving along the circumference, it is not rotating about its point. Okay, so at various point, this is like a ferry wheel where the smiling faces remains at the same location. So in this case, there is no rotationality. This I will show you mathematically also. In this case, if you take the product of the azimuthal velocity and the radius, it is constant. So 2 pi r, so 2 pi r v is a constant, and this is called as a circulation. So v, the azimuthal velocity is given by the circulation divided by 2 pi r, which is shown here. The radial velocity is also zero in this problem. And this is the expression for the vorticity in the z direction. So if substitute u and v, you will find that in this case, the vorticity comes out to be zero. So as I had shown in this through this smiling faces, since mathematically I am demonstrating that the vorticity is zero in this case, and this is an irrotational. So the previous problem of flow inside a rotating cylinder was a rotational flow, because in that case, the fluid, when it is moving along its circumference, it was also rotating while it is translating. Whereas in this case, when it is translating on a circle, it is not rotating about its axis. So this is an irrotational flow. After introducing the vorticity and the rotational and irrotational flow, let us move on to the flow visualization. Whenever we study fluid mechanics, we try to visualize, we try to represent the results which we obtain in terms of certain figures and graphs for a better visual, because with visual representation, we can get a better story of the fluid dynamic phenomena. So for visualization, there are certain lines which are presented, which are shown here, streamline, streak line, and path line. Along with this, we have certain other plots like profile plot, vector plot, and contour plot. So this will be discussed in this topic. So whether you do an experiment or competition, you want to have a visual examination of the flow field feature, because you can collect a lot of data, but to make a meaningful story of the fluid mechanics, you want to represent it in terms of certain figures, pictures, and movies. So this is useful in physical experiment as well as numerical experiment, which we do in computer simulations. All of you know that a picture is worth a thousand words. So we represent the big data which we generate through simulation software, through experiments, to create pictures or movies of the flow. Streamline, although I introduced earlier, that it's a curve that is everywhere tangent to the instantaneous velocity vector. So the flow cannot cross a streamline because it is following the path of the streamline. So there cannot be flow across a streamline. It is always tangent to the streamline. It's an indicator of instantaneous direction of fluid motion throughout the flow field. So if you have a streamline, you can get an idea of the nature of the fluid flow. Like this is one of the movie corresponding to the periodic state. It's a clip of movie corresponding to the vortex shedding periodic flow, where it's the flow across a cylinder. This is an instantaneous streamline. Now you can, by looking into this, you can get idea that if you consider this streamline, it means that the direction of flow is tangent to a streamline, so it is going like this. Let me show it to you. So if you consider any streamline, it is this, so it is going like this. The flow is going like this, then it is moving like this. This tangent with at all the points in the streamline. So this is the direction in this streamline. If you consider this streamline, which means that the flow is moving in this direction. Although you are not sure about the direction of motion, whether it's a clockwise or anti-clockwise, but at least to get an idea that the flow is circulating. But based on the direction of flow separation, I can say it is moving in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, so in this streamline, it's a circular streamline. And any circular streamline indicate that the fluid is rotating. This is what we call as vortex, which I had introduced earlier. So a closed streamline, like this streamline and this streamline, this is a clockwise vortex. Okay, so this is a closed streamline. These are like open streamline. Okay, whereas this is a closed streamline. So the closed streamline gives us an idea about that this region corresponds in the flow region corresponds to a vortex, where the fluid is rotating. Here you have a what I call as clockwise vortex, and here you have a anti-clockwise vortex. So this is a instantaneous picture for streamlines, where I'm showing you many streamlines. Now I'll play this movie and I've stopped the movie here. Now at this time instant, you can see that the size of the vortex on the bottom half, the size of the flow, the circular streamline which you are seeing here, the size is increased. So the size of the vortex has increased. The size of the anti-clockwise rotating fluid has increased. Now, let me go back slightly. So this is like maximum size of the vortex, which is growing from the bottom half. When it has reached to almost maximum size, now you can see there is a vortex which will, as soon as this anti-clockwise vortex will break away, there is a clockwise vortex which will form. Like you see, as soon as this has, this anti-clockwise rotating vortex has moved downstream, a clockwise vortex has formed. Now, when I play the movie, just see this clockwise rotating fluid region, the size of the clockwise rotating fluid region will increase. You can see now it is increasing, and now it is reaching to its maximum size, and then the size of the vortex, you can see now it is reaching to its maximum size. When this clockwise vortex breaks, another anti-clockwise vortex forms at the bottom half. So alternatively, the vortex is formed on the lower half and upper half of the rear of the cylinder. And this is what is called as vortex shedding. This is a vortex which is represented by the circular streamline, closed streamline. So this is a representation of a streamline. Along with the streamline can be observed experimentally. What I showed you earlier is the streamline which has been obtained from a numerical simulation. Streamline cannot be observed experimentally except in the steady flow, because in that case it coincides with two other lines which can be seen experimentally. There are three lines which I'll be discussing here: streamline, path line, and straight line. So you cannot observe experimentally streamline. You can observe path line and straight line, which I'll discuss little later. However, when the flow reaches to a steady state, all these lines are same. So under that condition, you can see the streamline experimentally. Otherwise, in an unsteady flow situation, you cannot observe streamline experimentally. Mathematically, you can obtain its expression. I will show you its expression. Let us consider a streamline. Let us suppose this is a streamline. And let us draw an arc which is tangent to the streamline. Let's first draw a velocity vector at any point. So the velocity vector is given by, this is u vector, it has two components. This is the x component and this is the y component. We draw an arc which is tangent to this streamline. It will also be parallel to this. This is, let us say, dr. If I take its component, it will be dx, dy. So that if we apply, so there are similar triangles. So we can write for similar triangles. This dr is a vector. It's a position vector. Dr by u vector is equals to dx by x component of the velocity, dy by y component of the velocity, which will be v. So from this you obtain along a streamline you are having an equation dy by dx is equals to v by u. This is your equation for a streamline. Along a streamline, dy by dx, this I am showing you for a two-dimensional situation. You can also stream along, you can also have a stream tube which is like a bundle of streamline. So if you have a bundle of streamline, like if you have bundle of, so this is just a representation of a bundle of streamline. This is called as stream tube. Note that in this case, so it's a bundle of streamline and fluid cannot, anyway, a fluid cannot cross a streamline, so it can also, it cannot also cross a stream tube because stream tube is also a bundle of streamline. It gives an idea of the flow rate, average velocity in the fluid. Like the stream tube which I had shown, it was like a converging cross section. So it gives an indication that the average velocity along the flow direction is increasing. After the streamline, the next line which I am presenting here is a path line. So it basically gives you the actual path traveled by an individual fluid particle over some time period. Like if you take your video camera and if there is a tracer particle which is massless, and if you put it in a flowing fluid, and if you create a movie of how that tracer particle is moving along with respect to time, then that movie is like a path line. It's, if you draw the locus of that, you can get a path line. So it's a Lagrangian concept where you follow the fluid particle material, fluid particle position vector over some time interval. So if you take, as I mentioned, if you take a massless tracer particle which is neutrally buoyant, which is not affecting the flow, you can, and if you take your video camera and create, and if you can detect that tracer particle while you are making this movie, then if you take the locus of at different time instant, you get the positions, and if you take the locus of it, it's like a path line. So there is an experimental technique which is called as particle image velocity, velocimetry, which is utilizes path line to measure the velocity fields. Mathematically, we can obtain the location at any time instant of the tracer particle by this expression, where the position vector at any time instant is equal to the starting position, the position vector at the starting location, plus even do a time integration from t start to that time. After presenting the streamline and the path line, the last line which I am presenting is what is called a streak line. It is locus of a fluid particle that has passed sequentially through a prescribed point in the flow. Like if you take a point when the fluid is flowing continuously, if you release, let us suppose a die at some location, water is flowing, let us suppose somewhere, and if at some location you are injecting dye at one location in the flow, then this gives you what we call a streak line. Like similarly, in an airflow, if you release smoke at one point, then the way the smoke moves or the dye moves in a water flow, that gives you the streak line. This you can observe experimentally. The path line you can observe, which I had shown earlier, as I said, if you create a movie and where you can see the tracer particle. Streak line you can observe experimentally, because when you inject a dye in water, how the dye is moving at different time instant, you can observe through the pictures, you would say, because this dye has a separate different color than the water. Similarly, the smoke trajectory in an airflow, when you release it at some location, you can observe it like this. So experimentally, you can observe the streak line. So you can observe the path line and streak line experimentally, but you cannot observe the streamline experimentally. However, under steady state, all these three lines are seen, and you can observe straight line, which is same as the path line and the streak line. Note that this gives us the integrated tracer particle locations, and you can obtain the location at. The streak line can be expressed by the position vector. This is the point at which you are injecting the dye or the smoke. And this is the time integrations for the velocity with respect to time, from time at which you are injecting to the present time. So you can get a particle location at any time instant in a streak line by this expression. Streamline represents instantaneous flow pattern. Because streamline at each and every, if you consider an unsteady flow, you have a fluid dynamics picture which is varying with respect to time. So for streamline gives you at a particular instant what is the direction of the flow. Whereas the path line involves and time-wise information, like it involves the trajectory of the fluid particle at different time instants. Whereas streak line involves time integrated information. So the path line and streak line have some age. They involve time in their computations or calculations. Path line, as I mentioned, it's like when you create a movie, you are exposing the picture for various time instants. It's a time exposed flow path of individual particle over some time period. This time period, it could be the time period for which you are creating the movie. Whereas streak line is an instantaneous snapshot of time integrated flow pattern. Like at some point you are releasing smoke, and at various time instant you can see the trajectory of the smoke. So the streak line is an instantaneous snapshot of time integrated information, because at a certain point you are injecting and it is following trajectory. It has certain time history, and that is what is seen in the instantaneous. So it's a time integrated flow pattern. Under steady flow condition, when I say, I mean the local time-wise variation of the, at each and every point in the flow, the velocities are not changing with respect to time. And when things are not changing with respect to time, then the path line and streak line, you can say basically degenerates into a streamline. And all these three lines are same. Along with this line, when we do experiments or computations, we can generate plot for those. But other than those plots, we also draw set. When we get velocities, pressures, and then we draw three types of plot. First, which we call as profile plot. Second, which we call as vector plot. And third, which we call as contour plot. I have already shown you a contour plot of vorticity distribution, where from computations the vorticity was obtained. So it's like there are various points in which value of vorticity was obtained, and that it was plotted as, I had shown you the solid line and the dotted dashed line, where dashed line was corresponding to the negative vorticity clockwise rotation, and the solid line was corresponding to the anti-clockwise rotation. So later on, I will show you a series of figures corresponding to profile plot, vector plot. Like for an internal flow in a plane channel, if you draw, so this I had shown earlier also, this is the flow in a pipe or a channel, where this is the velocity with which fluid is entering. This is the growth of boundary layer. And let us suppose this is the velocity distribution. So this is called as what is called as velocity profile at this location. This is the velocity profile. This is called as profile plot. This is the variation of the actual velocity in the radial direction. So this and this are what is called as velocity profile plot. What I am showing you here is the same phenomenon of flow process cylinder. I am showing you vortex shedding. However, I had shown you earlier the vorticity contours and the stream length. In this figure, I am showing the velocity vectors. Now you can see, once you have the data, I mean velocity is a vector quantity. So the data which you obtained is the x component of velocity, y component of the velocity, and the position vectors. So when you do an experiment or computation, there are certain points where you have got the data. Corresponding to those points, you have x coordinate, y coordinate, u velocities, and v velocities. So once you have the u velocities and v velocities, you can calculate the resultant velocity and you can define a scale and you can also calculate the direction. And based on that, you can plot a, what you call as vector plot, where you can see wherever the, you can see the direction of the flow as well as the magnitude of the flow. So here you can see that the fluid is rotating in the anticlockwise direction. Here you can see that the fluid is rotating in the clockwise direction. So this is a vector plot. I will play this movie. So you can see here there is an anticlockwise vortex which is formed. So this is the velocity vector plot which I mentioned. For vector quantity, we draw this vector plot. Scalar quantity, typically like temperature, we plot it like a contour plot. So the velocity, we can plot it like this vector plot. But in the earlier slide, I had shown you, I have plotted velocity profile. So velocity can be plotted like a profile plot, or it can be plotted in a field, because that profile plot is at some actual location. Whereas this vector plot is in the complete flow region. So this is a velocity plot for the velocity field as a vector plot. When we draw contour plot, there are two types of contour plots which are drawn. Like for vorticity, I could have drawn the flooded color contour, which I had shown in lecture on introduction, where I have shown blue region corresponding to the clockwise vortex, red region corresponding to the anticlockwise vortex. So that is like a color contour. In today's lecture, when I had shown you vorticity, I had shown you by lines. So those are called as line contours. So the contours are presented in terms of line. Contour plots can be presented in two types, line contour and flooded color contour. When we use line contour, we provide label corresponding to this. When we have flooded color contour, we provide certain color bar, which I had shown in my previous lecture for vorticity. This is a profile plot, and this is the velocity vector plot. So with this, I had come to the end of the section on the flow visualization. Now this is the last subsection corresponding to the Reynolds transport theorem. In the starting of this lecture on fluid kinematics, I had shown you the relationship between the total derivative and the partial derivative corresponding to the acceleration, which were expressed in terms of derivatives. Whenever we have derivatives, we are taking the size of the control volume delta x delta y tending to zero. Whereas in this Reynolds transport theorem, we consider a much larger size of the control volume and we do an integral formulations. In thermodynamics, you have considered system where where we are considering the fixed mass and there is no change in the shape and size and no mass crosses this boundary. Where in the fluid mechanics, we more commonly use the control volume and we allow mass to go in and out of the control volume. Because as I mentioned earlier, in fluid mechanics, we follow a fixed region approach. So we take a fixed region or which that we call as a control volume. And the surface of the control volume, we call that as control surface. In certain special cases, the control volume can move or deform, but it is not common. The common is stationary control volume. This Reynolds transport theorem provides a relationship between the rate of change of extensive property for a system and for a finite size control volume. In thermodynamics, you might have studied about extensive properties and intensive properties. What is extensive property? Extensive properties are those properties which depend on mass. Like when you apply law of conservation of mass and momentum. So when you apply law of conservation of mass, you encounter a variable which is mass. So mass let me represent by this symbol. And when we apply law of conservation of momentum, then momentum is typically expressed as mass multiplied by u velocity. Now here in Reynolds transport theorem, any extensive property, these are extensive property, we will represent it by capital B. Or we will also have another variable b, small b. We will have another variable small b, which is defined as capital B divided by m. So for mass conservation, for here small b will be 1. And here small b will be velocity. So in the Reynolds transport theorem, what we will do is that we will obtain a general expression for the rate of change of extensive property. Here we will obtain a general expression. But later on, for the later topics, we apply for the specific extensive property. Like later on for mass conservation, we will use a Reynolds transport theorem for rate of change of mass for a finite size control volume. And for momentum, the extensive property will be momentum. So capital B is mass into velocity and small b will be per unit mass term, which is u. So in the later topics, we will use the general expressions which we derive here, which is corresponding to rate of change of any extensive property. So here we are defining a relationship between, I started this topic where I had discussed the rate of change of the flow property in a differential form and correlated it for a control volume. So the first topic in this lecture on fluid kinematics was on description of flow property and its rate of change. Whereas in the last lecture also, you can see that we are correlating rate of change of extensive property. There it was for a flow property, here it is for extensive property, for a system and for a control volume. Earlier was a differential relationship, here it's an integral relationship. So let us take a control volume with one inlet and one outlet. So this is a control volume, which does not change with respect to time. However, if you consider a fixed system at time t, you will find, so this brown region, which I showed earlier, this is the brown region. This is a system at time t, and this green region is system or the mass of the fluid which is in this brown region. The same mass of the fluid at t plus delta t, it has moved to this green region. Whereas, so this brown region corresponds to control volume which does not change with respect to time. This brown region represents control volume at t as well as t plus delta t. Whereas for a system, the brown region is the system or the mass of the fluid in this region at t, the same mass of the fluid at t plus delta t, which is corresponding to system at t plus delta t, shown by green region. Note that here our objective is to correlate the rate of change of an extensive property for a system as compared to that at the control volume. So to correlate it, what we find is that when the mass of the fluid in the brown region at time t plus delta t, it has moved to this green region. Now, if you look into the green region and try to see what is the difference between the brown and the green region, what you find is that this is like at T plus, when it moves to T plus delta P, this is a newly covered region, and this is an uncovered region. So this region we will call as 1, and this region we will call as 2. So at time T, system and control volume occupy same fluid and same region. At T plus delta T, system occupies same fluid, the change in occupied region. Now, what is the change in the occupied region? It is this control volume is the brown region minus this uncovered region plus this newly covered region. So, if we write any extensive property B, and this is a per intensive property, if you divide by mass, as I had mentioned earlier. So at time t, the B for a system and B for a control volume is same, whereas B for system at t plus delta t, you will use this relationship. B for system at t plus delta t, at t both are same, which is shown here. At t plus delta t, B system is equals to B control volume minus B1 plus B2 as shown. Now what we will do is that if you take the difference of B system at T plus delta T, so if you subtract this minus this, you will get B system at T plus delta T minus B system at T, and if you divide by delta T and you apply the limit del delta T tends to 0, you can get a derivative dB system by dt as shown. Similarly, if you this minus this divided by delta t and limit delta t tends to give you this expression. But there is, and so this, what I am showing you here corresponds to this divided by delta t term and this divided by delta t term. I will show you mathematically how this is coming. So if you take B1 at t plus delta t divided by delta t, so you can see that this B1, I can write it in terms of small b multiplied by mass. Now mass, I can write it in terms of density multiplied by volume. Basically, I have to take the volume of this uncovered region, this region. I have to take the volume of this volume. I can write it like the area multiplied by U1 into A1. So I will write it like U1 into delta T. So this is like this horizontal distance, and I am multiplying by the area. So this gives me the approximate volume. And this, if I divide by delta T, this is equal to B1 rho. Let us, if I consider density is also varying, this will be rho 1 into U1. There will be area also which will be coming here. Okay, so the volume of this uncovered region, note that I am expressing it in terms of area multiplied by this velocity U1 into delta T. U1 into delta T into this area A1 is, I am considering the volume of the uncovered region. Similarly, this newly covered region, I can write it like A2, which is the area of this, multiplied by U2 into delta T. So using that, I get B2 T plus delta T divided delta T is equals to B2 rho 2 U2 A2. So this is shown here. So if you divide this by delta T, these two terms by delta T, and as I showed you here, you get this term. So this is the final expression which has been obtained, which shows that this is the rate of change of any extensive property for a system. This is equals to the rate of change of that extensive property for a control volume plus B dot net is basically the net outflux. You are taking the rate at which that extensive property is moving out of the control volume minus what is entering. This gives the net outflux of that extensive property. So this is a relationship between the rate of change of an extensive property for a system and a for a control volume. They are correlated by a term which is net outflux. If I compare this with the, if you compare this with the, for the first topic, we had a similar relation, the rate of change I have mentioned, that in an Eulerian approach, when you follow control volume approach, there are two terms. Here also you can see that there are two terms. This is the rate of change inside the control volume. This is the rate of change due to the mass flow rate across the surface of the control volume. So when you use a fixed mass system, the rate of change is a single term. But when you use the fixed region or fixed control volume, there are two rate of change. This is the local rate of change, and this is coming from the advection or so there we have local acceleration and advective acceleration. Similarly, but the difference is there it was for a elemental control volume where we, when you obtain a differential term, it is delta x delta y tending to zero. Whereas the control volume which you are taking here are reasonably large size. So here you get an equation which I will show you a little later as an integral equation. There it was a differential equation. This B net, which represents the net outflux of this extensive property, is expressed as in the earlier slide I had shown you. It is basically we are basically expressing this as in terms of surface area, and surface area we are expressing in terms of its normal unit vector. So this U2 A2 we will write as U vector dot the normal of the any surface into surface area vector. So basically we are writing rho B U on a surface, which is a vector, and this N is a normal unit vector to a surface. I will draw this surface and show it to you. So let us take a surface. Let us suppose this is a surface in which any surface, the direction is given by the unit outward normal. So let us suppose this is the normal. If let us say the velocity is acting in this direction, this is our velocity vector, and then the theta, which the theta is corresponding to this, is the angle between the two, and if that theta is less than 90 degree, so here if the theta is less than 90 degree, then we call it as an outflow. When theta is less greater than 90 degree, we call it as an inflow. Okay, and so when it is greater than 90 degree, you have a negative sign, and when it is greater than less than 90 degree, then you have a positive sign. So you get the net outflux from this expression. The extensive property, the total amount of extensive property, can be expressed in terms of intensive property. So the capital B for a control volume can be expressed in terms of small b by doing an integral over a control volume b dm, and that dm can be rho into dv. So you can have a volume integral and you can get the total extensive property as a volume integral in terms of intensive property. So this is the expression. In the earlier slide I had shown you this d by dt was outside, but if you have a stationary control volume, and if the control volume is not deforming with respect to time, then you can take that. So whether it doesn't matter for whether you do the integration first or whether you do the differentiation derivative time derivative first. So the derivative can be taken inside the integral. However, the earlier in the previous slide, let me show you. What I'm saying is this term d by dt, this b control volume I'm expressing as volume integral of rho small b dv. Now this d by dt, it's a total derivative. So whether you do the integration first and then you do the take the derivative, or whether you first take the derivative or do the integration, it doesn't matter if the control volume is not moving and it is not deforming. So for such cases, you can take this derivative inside the integral. However, when you take it inside the integral, this rho rho and this b can vary with space. So instead of total derivative, you have to take this as partial derivative. However, for moving and deforming control volume, this d by dt, you cannot make it partial and take it inside the integral. You have to keep it outside. And this is a more general case for moving and deforming control volume. And for moving and deforming control volume, note that then your frame of reference will be also such that the velocity which we'll consider for inflow and outflow, you have to consider the relative velocity. Okay, so for when you consider a steady flow, so like in the earlier case, when we consider steady flow, the local acceleration was zero. Similarly here, this when for a steady flow, this term will be equal to zero. And the time derivative of the for a system of extensive property will be basically given by this flux term. I have taken an example of nozzle flow where I have shown you that in a steady flow in a nozzle, the local acceleration is equal to zero. But there was an adaptive acceleration, and if you consider acceleration in Lagrangian system, it is non-zero because the adaptive acceleration is non-zero. Similarly, here I am showing you that when it's a steady flow, this term is zero, although this term is zero. But for a system, you have a certain time variation, which is corresponding to the variation which you see in with the help of this outflux of the extensive property. So finally, as I had been correlating this last topic with the previous topic, the statement corresponds to that. Renault transport theorem, which is corresponding with this topic for a finite control volume where we are obtaining an integral formulation, is analogous to material derivative for infinitesimal differential volumes, which we have considered in the first topic. With this, I had come to the end of this lecture, and these are some of the reference books for this topic. Thank you for your attention.